Yeah, so today I'm excited to have the chance to tell you about some research that's going on in my lab at the University of Michigan, just over in the chemistry building. And we're really interested in understanding how kind of the physical properties of membranes, which is an important part of the cell, how it can contribute to the things that cells do kind of on an everyday basis. And I think this kind of project, one of the cool things about it that I think is more general is that it's kind of an example of how biology has now reached this point where physicists can really jump in and start asking and answering really interesting questions. And I think this is a good example of that. So hopefully by the end of this, I'll convince you that we have a chance at understanding some of these complex biological processes. So I'm going to start off by explaining some of the words that I use. In particular, I just wanted to start off by explaining what a cell is. So cells are kind of the inherent building blocks of our tissues and organs. In fact, we start off from a single cell. It's a large cell, but a single cell. So right after the egg is fertilized with sperm, there's one cell. And in this movie, I started at the two-cell stage, but these are zebrafish eggs, embryos that have been fertilized. And just like us, they start off from single cells, here two cells, just because it's easier to see. And in this case, over about 24 hours, that single cell divides into lots of smaller cells. And those cells, they first initially just divide, and then they start to differentiate and take on different shapes. At some point, you can start seeing, there's kind of structure. You can sort of make out an eye, where the eye will be, and there's the spine of these fish. And then even later, muscles start to develop, and they start to activate. And so the swimming / twitching that you see is these muscles starting to develop. So if we let this go for another equivalent of 24 hours, you would have swimming fish. So for us, this takes obviously much longer. But it's really amazing that from a single cell, we get all of these complicated structures. And with a little bit of help, of course, from the egg in the mother's womb, or wherever we end up starting off. Okay, so from that single cell, there ends up being many cells. And a couple of examples of the types of cells that are in our body, one of them is a red blood cell. And the primary function of these cells is to transport oxygen around our tissues. We have epithelial cells. So these cells make up kind of the boundaries of our linings of many of our organs. This is an example of something in our intestines. So these cells have to decide which nutrients to absorb and which ones to leave behind. There are other types of cells. This is an example of a cardiac cell or a heart cell. And these cells are amazing. Even if you isolate them from a heart, they beat on their own. And these cells are responsible for making sure that our heart keeps on beating so that this blood can be transferred around our body. The primary cells of our brains are neurons, and these cells are responsible for sensing and processing and communicating information. And they have very distinct structures and are very beautiful. And the last one I'll mention are immune cells. So these cells travel in our blood and in our lymph, and they're responsible for this complicated dance that decides some substance found in your body is an invader and should be gotten rid of, like the cold that I have right now, and when that it's just your tissues and it should be left alone. So all of these cells have very different but very important jobs, and it's really amazing that they can do the things that they can do. And one thing that they all have in common is that they're bounded by a cell membrane, sometimes called the plasma membrane, and this is the outer boundary of these cells. Okay, so what is a membrane? It's a very thin layer of molecules. It's actually only two molecules thick. It has a lot in common with something you're probably more familiar with, which we have set up here. Hopefully it'll work. Ah, yay. Some bubbles. So, yeah. They're not flying high today. I understand. Okay, so a bubble is a thin layer of water that is bounded by special molecules called surfactants, soapy molecules. these molecules like to go to the interface between water and hydrophobic substances like air or oil, and they stabilize this interface. So the way they accomplish this is that they have two sides to them. On one side, they have a part that likes to be close to water. It's polar. And the other side wants to point away from water, so it's nonpolar. And that's what stabilizes these amazing structures. So a membrane is very similar, but it all happens underwater. So instead of a thin layer of water, we're now surrounded by water, and we have a thin layer of oily substance. But in this case, the oily substance is not oil. It's the chains of these lipids. They have a very similar structure to common soaps. Right? They have this hydrophilic side that likes to be near water, and a hydrophobic side that likes to be away from water. And the hydrophobic side's a little bigger in this case, so you can make this layer without having to have a layer of oil in the middle. So a little bit of history. This whole field was begun by a woman, Angus Pockels, who had no scientific training. She was doing experiments on materials that she found in her kitchen. And she spent many years doing experiments and tried to communicate her findings to the local scientific community and was ignored. And eventually she sent a letter with some of her results to Sir Rayleigh of Rayleigh Scattering. And he thought it was exciting enough to contribute to Nature, where it was published. And since then, she published several papers in Nature, and she's really the parent of this field of surface science. The instrument that she built out of very simple materials was slightly modified by Langmuir and was part of what contributed to him getting the Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1932. So it's one of the rare fields in science, I think, that starts off with a woman that's actually documented in history. Okay, so these are vesicles. These are membranes, spherical membranes, similar to our bubbles. So they're a lot like these soap bubbles, but they're underwater. So think of a water balloon in a bathtub. In this case, and in most cases, they're much smaller than the bubbles that we encounter in our normal lives. And this is probably because they don't have this layer of oil. It's a little bit more fragile, so they tend to be smaller. Because they're smaller, we have to look at them under microscopes. And this is a younger me looking at them under microscopes. And the reason they're glowing in this picture is we've added in a small amount of a fluorescent dye, so a molecule that glows under a particular color of light. And this lets us see them at high contrast in our microscopes. Okay, so cells are bounded by these membranes, these bubbles. But these are not your standard bubble. These membranes can do some amazing things. So this is one of the classic examples of the wonders of biology. This is a macrophage. It's a type of white blood cell. It's a type of immune cell. And its job is to find and take bacteria out of the picture. So that's the bacteria, which is the villain in this story. And then also in this movie, there's some red blood cells, which are there just to be distractions. And this amazing movie. Yeah, it's very dramatic. Yes. That's awesome. Okay, I'll let you watch it again. It's so awesome. So this cell is doing a lot of things, and a lot of these things are happening through this membrane. It's sensing that the bacteria is nearby. It kind of knows where it is. It localizes it. It knows that the red cells are different than the bacteria, so it's chasing the bacteria, not the red cell. Yeah. It's localizing it, so it knows where it is, so it can chase it. It's communicating this information to inside the cell, and so that the cell can make some of these motions happen. It has to deform in certain ways to pursue this invader. And then when it finally catches it, it has to grab it and engulf it so that the cell can digest it and get rid of it. So how does the cell do this? It's just magical. And not all the things happen at the membrane, but a lot of these things happen through the membrane. So if we take a closer look at this membrane, it's made up of this lipid bilayer that I've already told you about, but in this bilayer are embedded proteins. These proteins are responsible for a lot of these higher order functions. So things like detecting the chemicals that are shed by the bacteria, pushing the membrane so that it deforms to go in the right direction, and grabbing the bacteria when it's close enough to touch it. So proteins, one of the ways we think about them is little molecular machines. And I love this picture. So they are bigger and much more complicated than lipids. Membrane proteins are confined to be within the bilayer. So they have hydrophobic bits that kind of anchor them to this membrane. So with this, in this context, our central question is, do cells take advantage of some of the interesting physics of their membranes to do some of these amazing things? And of course, I think the answer is yes. And hopefully I'll be able to convince you of some of that. Okay, so, but before I can get there, I need to explain some of the physics that I'm talking about. So the membrane's a fluid, two-dimensional fluid, but we're more familiar with three-dimensional fluid. So here's the phase diagram of water. And this is basically a roadmap that tells you under what conditions do you get what kind of physical state of this material. So water, bulk water, what we're familiar seeing, corresponds to something like that, a point like there in the diagram. And if we increase temperature at constant pressure, then we boil this water away. That's a boiling transition that we're more familiar with. And in that transition, we go from water to water vapor coexistence to vapor. You can also go from water to vapor without going through this coexistence region, without having a clear what's the difference between water and liquid, by going around something called this critical point. And so if you could control pressure and temperature so that you could walk this kind of complicated path, you could go from water to vapor without there being a real clear distinction between the two. So this intuitively is very difficult for me. And it's not something we encounter in our everyday lives. Here's another way of looking at the same thing. Instead of pressure versus temperature, now this is temperature versus density. And so boiling water is like going upwards on this phase diagram through this phase boundary. Going around the critical point corresponds to kind of a complicated path in this direction. We can also go through the critical point through the two-phase region. And here we go from two coexisting phases to one phase, also in a kind of a continuous gradual way. And we have a bunch of examples of this to show. But the take-home message here is that it's possible, though, as you can see, it's kind of difficult, for water especially, to continuously pass between a liquid and a vapor phase. So we have an amazing demo. Of this phenomenon in freon. So water has a much more complicated, or much higher pressures and temperatures where you see this type of transition. But in freon, it's much closer to atmospheric conditions, so we can actually see it. So we have a closed container, and temperature is raising right now, and we go from having a liquid and a vapor in coexistence. And as temperature is raised, we should see that meniscus disappear. What happens is you kind of see this cloudy, the interface kind of becomes cloudy and then it goes away. Yeah, awesome. So on the way back down, it might be more, 2 out of 3 times it's more magnificent. So hopefully it's one of those 2 times. So let me explain a little bit what's going to happen. So when you pass through one of these critical points, the free energy cost to assembling or disassembling a pocket of fluid and gas or a pocket of gas and fluid becomes very small compared to thermal energy. And so what that means is that these packets can, these kind of fluctuations, these density fluctuations can happen just due to thermal fluctuations. And in this system, the way this looks is that the setup becomes cloudy because there's pockets of all of these different structures that happen on a range of different length scales, and they scatter light of a range of different wavelengths. I think we're starting to see it rain. Yeah?
So are we seeing basically a soup of two phases?
So this is a one-phase system, but it has kind of hints that the phase transition is close by. So there's signatures that you're about to go through a phase transition. In a way that when you're normally boiling water, there isn't the same kind of hint that it's about to happen. If there were no impurities in your pan and stuff like that, yeah. Oh, no. Real science is harder. Time. Takes a little while because all of the exciting stuff happens within about a degree, half a degree of the transition. And so the temperature was raised, and then now we have to let it slowly drift down to lower temperature. I know. Everyone look away. Yeah, that's true. Huh. Could show my... So. It's going to be slow. That's okay. We're almost giving up on it. So right, so it's becoming cloudy because there's lots of fluctuations, composition fluctuations. And these, they have all different sizes and they scatter light on all different length scales. Ah, beautiful. And then we can see the meniscus is rising up. So those are the two phases in coexistence. And amazing thing is that this fog extends kind of into the fluid phase too. So this is not the world we live in, mostly. Okay, I have a few more examples from YouTube. It'll go a little faster. This is CO2. It's another compound that has a critical point kind of at a reasonably accessible range. And this is an example when you're far from a critical point, where you're just going through a normal first order transition. So in this case, we saw the meniscus rise as temperature was raised, and now it's lowering again as temperature comes down. So this is not very exciting, in my opinion. This is more like the world we live in. But this is when you start off with a critical composition, so just the right mixture of liquid and vapor. You again see this cloudiness as you go through the transition. And I like this movie, too, because you see this very wiggly boundary as this meniscus returns. And that's because there's capillary waves on this surface. And it's, again, very low energy to kind of deform this surface, so it happens with just thermal fluctuations. So those were liquid-gas coexistence examples. The same thing can happen in two different liquids. And so in this is similar to our setup here, with its cyclohexane and methanol mixed together, and temperature is now lowering, and we again go through this called critical opalescence. So critical systems are amazing. For lots of reasons. One of the main reasons is that they're universal. So I just showed you three examples of three different, completely different systems, different chemicals. And they all look very similar. And in fact, mathematically, physically, there are properties of these systems that are identical, that can be explained by the same very simple theory. And the detailed molecular interactions that give rise to where this critical point happens to be and what the phase diagram details are, at some point those don't matter anymore to explaining the types of structures that you see. And this remarkable discovery was one of the exciting things, I think, of the mid-1900s. Got a Nobel Prize in physics in 1982, in theoretical physics. The theorist got the Nobel Prize. There were many more experiments that it would have had to have been spread between, I think. So back to membranes. I wouldn't have told you this long story if there weren't some of this kind of interesting stuff happening in membranes. So these are now vesicles under slightly different conditions than the ones that I showed you before. And in these, the probe is distributed heterogeneously. Okay, so the vesicles are brighter on one side than the other. And they are this way because they contain two distinct liquid phases. So like methanol and cyclohexane, but here these are phases in the bilayer plane. So one of these phases is called the liquid disordered phase. And the name doesn't really matter, but that's the one that's bright in this picture. And the dark phase is called liquid ordered. And they're different in that they have different chemical compositions. And when the right lipids are mixed together in these vesicles, you can see them actually separate. So here's a phase diagram for one of these lipid mixtures. Details, again, don't matter, but there is a critical point. And so this is the equivalent of going through the phase transition far from one of these critical points. You start off with a vesicle that's uniform, and as we lower temperature, there's a well-defined temperature where it breaks out into these spots. These spots coarsen, they get bigger by running into each other. It looks a lot like a two-dimensional salad dressing bottle or a lava lamp, something like that. So something a little more familiar. When we start off with a composition that's very special, so that it goes through one of these critical points at the transition, we again see these amazing fluctuations. And now we're looking at them under the microscope. And it starts off as just flickering. And as temperature lowers, the flickering gets more obvious. At some point, you can actually see them getting bigger than the point spread function of the microscope. Here is very close to the critical point. Yeah, this one too. And below, we see that there's two distinct phases, but there's a very wiggly boundary between the phases. So these, again, are these capillary waves. So in two dimensions, the simplest system that gives you these critical fluctuations is called the two-dimensional Ising model. And it's very, very simple. I'm an experimentalist, and I can even do these simulations. It's a lattice of spins. They're either up or down, or in this case, yellow or green. You throw in thermal energy and some nearest neighbor interactions, and you can see these kind of beautiful fluctuations that we see in our experiments. And in fact, we can show that they are the same in many ways as the ones we see in our experiment. We can compare them quantitatively, and remarkably, the physics that describes the simple Ising model also describes our experiments in a real membrane. So this, I think, is an amazingly powerful tool if we can apply it right. So when you're far from a critical point, if you want to have, you know, understand deeply what's happening on a kind of a smaller length scale, you need to know a lot about the system. Need to know things like, how do these lipids interact? What are their potentials? Do they have hydrogen bonding interactions? Do the chains wiggle more or less? Are there certain bonds, you know, angles that are preferred? You have to worry about electrostatics. Hydration, is water ordered? All these very complicated and interesting things, but things that we are certainly not quite to the place of being able to deal with quite yet. And progress is being made, but this is a hard way to go. If we happen to be so lucky that we're near one of these critical points, life becomes much, much simpler. We can describe the size of fluctuations, say, by this equation, only a couple of parameters. And these parameters are things that we can measure experimentally. So one of them is this critical temperature, which is not very hard to measure at all. And another one is this C naught, which is just a characteristic length of your system. A little harder to measure, not so bad. And also, we have a sense of what it should be. So maybe we don't even have to do the measurement all the time. So we went from very hard and probably will never understand to to we can do this with just two experiments. So that's amazing. So I think it opens up a lot of doors. So in these simple membranes, which are not so simple, it's two molecular layers, there's a hydrophobic and a hydrophilic bit, and there's lots of things to keep track of. There's many components actually in them too. In these systems, we can deeply understand them at this kind of fundamental physical level, which is very satisfying. But what I think is the most exciting is that this gives us a tool to expand to more complex systems. Biological membranes are much, much more complicated than the ones I've been showing you. And if we can apply some of these kind of physical tools that we've learned about to these biological systems, we have a chance of really understanding something. So that leads to my question. Does this happen in cells? So the way we started answering this question is by making membranes, vesicles from cells. So these are a white blood cell that's growing on a plastic plate. We've poisoned them slightly, coaxed them to blow these balloons with their plasma membranes. And then we can isolate them and look at them. So cells are complicated things, and these vesicles are much simpler than cells. One way that cells are complicated is that they're attached to a rigid kind of protein network, cytoskeletal network, and these vesicles are not. And that's one of the ways they're much simpler to work with. But they do contain a lot of these proteins and lipids that are found in the cell plasma membranes. If you take these isolated membranes in lower temperature, you see that they phase separate into these same two liquid phases. And this is the same kind of glowing lipid molecule that I'm using as a probe. You can sort proteins or lipids between these phases. And this system is a bit heterogeneous because it's a little messy. But if you look at any of these vesicles carefully and slowly step through temperatures, we see the same behavior that we've seen in these other systems. We see kind of flickering at a higher temperature. This flickering gets more and more obvious as we lower temperature. At some point, they get bigger than the point spread function of the microscope here, for sure. Now we're below the critical point, and we have two distinct phases, but a wiggly boundary between these phases. And in this experiment, I had the patients to go back up in temperature again, and we see these fluctuations come back again. So this is not this. There's lingering energy left in this system that is driving this interesting behavior. This is happening at equilibrium. Okay, so I said before that these critical systems are universal. And what this means is that if we plot our data in the right way, we would expect that the data from these complicated biological membranes and the simpler but still complicated model membranes would fall on top of each other, and they do. More than that, they all fall on top of this very simple two-dimensional Ising model, which is totally amazing and exactly as it should be, this great theory has been done to show that these systems are supposed to be universal. And all that matters is actually that these are in two dimensions. That's what sets this particular set of equations. So we're on our way. I think we can use, in some cases at least, we have some reason to believe we can use these very simple physical models and principles to really make predictions about cells. So one thing I should mention. So we only see these fluctuations at low temperatures. So the pictures I showed you were mostly around room temperature. And these are mammalian cells, and they have they grow normally at 37 degrees. So one of the big questions we get all the time is, can we, you know, great, this might be interesting that happening at room temperature, but does this ever happen in reality? And I think the answer is yes. And the way we think about it is that the cell lives kind of above this phase transition. And because it's not so far away, it can feel the effects. And these effects have many, many facets to them. And I'll talk about some of those in a little bit. OK, so this is the equation that we've showed applies to our data, at least at low temperature. If we believe this theory and these experiments so much that we can extrapolate to physiological temperatures, which in this case is about 15 degrees above where we're actually doing our experiments, we would predict roughly 20 nanometer size kind of composition fluctuations at growth temperatures. So this is a lot smaller than the microns that we see on the microscope, but it's still a lot bigger than the size of kind of the characteristic size of molecules in our system. So this has the potential for being a long-range kind of interaction between membrane components, or helping to mediate. So this is the picture. This is one of these Ising model simulations. And a few things to notice. This clustering is weak, so you're not seeing a lot of obvious structure. If I were to get rid of the background, you probably wouldn't guess these circles were organized at all. So the orange circles are a subset of the yellows, and the blue circles are a subset of the blues. And they're not special, I just pulled them out so we can actually see their dynamics. So there's a distribution of domain sizes. These individual molecules, or spins in this case, diffuse much faster than the background, even though the background is made up of identical molecules. And that's because a yellow guy tends to be replaced by another yellow guy when it diffuses away. And this is another feature of critical systems. It's called critical slowing down. So in this sense, these fluctuations are long-lived. In a real sense, if you were to let this integrate over time for some reasonable time, like a second, say, it would time average away to nothing. So there's probably other things that are helping stabilize the structure if it happens in cells. So we were very excited when we started getting these numbers, because this is very similar to something that biologists have been excited about for a while. There's been this idea that maybe lipids help organize proteins inside cells, and maybe this organization is key for their function. So this is one of the first cartoons that came out. And it's been pretty decisively shown that that simple picture doesn't exist. But the more kind of consensus right now is that in a normal cell that's not really doing anything or specialized to do anything, the membrane is slightly organized, but in a dynamic and heterogeneous way, and it's in a small over a small length scale. But that, upon some sort of activation event, this structure can be stabilized. And what we're describing from these fluctuations is a lot like the pictures that people have been drawing for these resting unstimulated cells. So maybe we're onto something. So this is a great idea, but we still have a long way to go to show that this is a reality. And so we've taken a few tacks at trying to address this question. One of them is to ask, what can we expect of this type of phenomena anyway? So what sort of, how could biology take advantage of these fluctuations to actually do something? And then the second big push has been to start looking in real cells, not isolated membranes from cells, and say, can we see evidence for this behaviors? So on the theoretical side of what trying to figure out what we could maybe say from this, I've had a wonderful collaboration with Ben Macta and Jim Sethna. Ben was a graduate student at Cornell when I was there as a postdoc, and we're still in great contact since. And so he published a whole bunch of papers kind of characterizing what we might expect to see from this. One of them is that these fluctuations can actually mediate long-range interactions between embedded proteins. So if you have two proteins that, in this case, prefer different local lipid environments, they actually feel a repulsion because they don't want to have to share neighboring lipids. If they like the same lipid in local environment, they'd feel a weak attraction because they like sharing the same lipids. Ben also showed that if you were to couple this membrane to something similar to a cortical actin meshwork, so the protein network that these cells, these membranes actually sit on in a real cell, that this can act to stabilize this structure. And it can do other interesting things like give you interesting dynamics for motions for molecules that strongly prefer one phase or the other. Ben's most recent work is thinking about how fluctuations could modulate internal states of proteins. So if you have like an ion channel, say, that can either be open or closed, and there's some free energy associated with that transition. If those states also have different preferences for their local lipid environment, then the lipids also contribute to the free energy of these two states. And so lipids could potentially modulate the activity of these ion channels or proteins. So this is something we're very excited about and are looking at experimentally as we speak. So, but generally, our idea is that these fluctuations could help kind of tune how proteins interact and the conformations that they can take, and that this could possibly be taken advantage of by cells to do stuff. Another of the big implications of this model is that the cell is kind of, the membrane is poised to respond. Critical systems are very compressible, which means that you don't have to nudge them very much for them to have a big response. And so an example is here, where we take one of our components, these orange circles, and we've clustered them through some external potential. So imagine I've forced them to be in the same place, but this is really a small subset of the total component. So this is a small perturbation in a real sense. Even though it's a fairly small perturbation, we see a really big change in the distribution of our yellow spins and blue spins. And this is because these proteins, the circles, drag along this kind of lipids around them and set up an energy landscape that they prefer to be closer. And so this is actually a means that cells use to propagate or initiate signals frequently, especially in immune cells. You start off with a receptor that is mobile and can do whatever it wants, and this receptor then binds to some ligand that acts to cluster it. And this is actually, the distribution of circles here is taken from electron micrograph of receptors that have been clustered in a real cell. So you could imagine if these are lipids, then it could really set up a nice lipid in a local environment around these receptors to facilitate some sort of signaling process. Right, so again, nice in theory. We would really like to be able to show this is true in cells. So one question, can we directly see these fluctuations? That's really the big question. And this is a hard one to answer, and one that we and many other groups have been trying to answer for a long time. The problem is that what we're predicting here is very small and very subtle. And the tools, experimental tools that have been available for a long time just aren't sensitive enough to see it. So this is 100 nanometers, and that's below the diffraction limit of visible light. So that means we can't just use a regular microscope for it. And so what we've been doing instead is using a new method that's been around for about 5 years now called super-resolution fluorescence localization microscopy. I'm not going to talk about the details of it now, but basically it lets us take a visible light image of whatever we want, in this case a cell, but instead of being limited by the 200, 250 nanometer optical resolution of visible light, we can now get it down to about 20 nanometers. Just on my microscope in a building right around, you know, on the other side of campus. So this work is by Matt Stone, who's here. And what the question, the way he posed this question is by being a little bit more specific, which is always good when you're really doing an experiment. And we're looking at the B cell receptor, which is one of these receptors found on one of these immune cells, B cell lymphocytes. And the question was, is the distribution of lipids around a given B cell receptor different than you'd expect from a random distribution? And what he did was he took two probes that look a lot like lipids, but they're proteins. They're anchored to the membrane through lipids, but them being proteins makes the experiment a little bit more technically feasible. And we have one that prefers this dark phase, and we have another that prefers this bright phase. And so the question is, and the experiment that he did is look at these probes using two-color super-resolution microscopy and ask, do these probes kind of see where the B cell receptors are? Do they localize differently because of the B cell receptors there? So he takes pictures that look like this. And the way this image is, you end up with a lot of spots that you superimpose, so the pictures look like you have a lot of spots. But we quantify these. So I think I'm excited. This is new data. And I think we can say we at least have a chance of seeing this. And I think maybe we have seen it, but we have to do a few more things. But basically, here's the data. So he's shown that the probe that likes this dark phase tends to like to be closer to the receptor. And these curves mean if a value of 1 says it is a random distribution, a value greater than 1 means that there's a recruitment over a length scale given by the x-axis. And a value less than 1 means that there's some exclusion. So compared to what you'd expect from a random distribution. And so he sees a preferential enrichment of our probe that likes this dark phase, and maybe preferential exclusion of this dye that likes the bright phase. So they do seem to be talking to each other. And we've chosen these lipid probes specifically so that we don't expect there to be other interactions. These should only be lipid mediated, but we of course need to do many more experiments to convince ourselves that's true. So the other exciting thing is that the magnitude of these interactions are consistent with our theoretical predictions. So it seems like we're on the right track. And so we have a lot of work to do. We need to look at other probe pairs. We need to see if this changes with temperature in the way we'd expect, just as we did in these vesicle studies. But if this holds up, I think it's a very exciting result. And I'm very excited that we can actually start doing these experiments that we've been wanting to do for so long. So a second question is do lipids reorganize in response to this external potential? So this is this picture again. So if we cluster our, so what Matt's done is he's clustered these B cell receptors and asked, now are these lipid probes even more strongly enriched or excluded? And he takes more pictures. They actually don't look that different. So red is this B cell receptor, and now it is a little bit more punctate than it was before. In these pictures, you can see, and at least in the second one, the BR and BCR and PM, you start to see some overlapping of red and green spots, and those look yellow in these types of pictures. So, again, I think this is a yes. This data is older and I think more substantial because the signals that we get are bigger. So, when we cluster this B cell receptor, our probe that liked to be close to the B cell receptor before likes it even more. So now our numbers on the y-axis are going from 1.3 to 2.5, which is a big change. Our probe that likes the disordered phase, like the bright phase, is now we can say safely that it's excluded. And again, the magnitude of these is both consistent with our theoretical predictions, and even more excitingly, it's starting to get to the point where you could imagine this actually doing something in a cell. So these are held together by interactions that have to be of order the thermal energy or more. So if you have some protein that has a low affinity for a receptor, say, and then you add this extra lipid affinity through the lipids, then maybe that's actually enough to tip the balance to make some signaling pathway go forward. So that's still fantasy, but at least we're kind of showing that this is a possible way that things might happen. Okay, the last question is, can we manipulate signaling, so functional processes within cells, by fiddling in ways we understand with lipid mixing? These are experiments done by Ellie Gray, who's also here. She started in my lab as a first-year undergraduate and has been an enormous asset. She's now going to be graduating with her master's. And what she's done is she's found a whole slew of small molecules, membrane-soluble small molecules, that change transition temperatures in vesicles, in these isolated plasma membrane vesicles, in a way that we that we can reproduce very well. So what we think these molecules do, so the way we think of what's going on in biology is that the cell lives at some temperature distance above this phase transition. And because of that, there's some fluctuations that linger because of the proximity to that critical point. So if we do something to lower the phase transition of the membrane, but we keep growth temperatures the same, we've now increased the temperature distance from this critical point. And what the theory predicts would happen is that would decrease the magnitude of fluctuations. They would get smaller and more subtle. And so these are potentially inhibitors of membrane heterogeneity or promoters if we have it go the other way. And so we would like to think that if we're onto something, then this could also manipulate these signaling pathways that presumably depend on these lipids. So the experiments that Ellie has done is to take immune cells, very similar to the ones that Matt was playing with, and look at a functional output. So we stimulate them with some antigen. This initiates a signaling cascade where lots of things, complicated things happen. One of the complicated things that happen is that calcium levels in the cytoplasm increase dramatically. And there are lots of great fluorophores out there that can sense calcium concentrations. So we can look at how that, whether or not that happens kind of under different circumstances. And so I have three movies here that I'm going to show you. One of them is no perturbation, so we haven't added any extra molecules, but we do stimulate it. Another one, we've added ethanol, which is one of these molecules that we know lowers this critical temperature, so it should suppress this lipid, these lipid fluctuations. And then we have another one, which is ethanol in combination with another compound that raises this back up. So it lets us address the question. Well, I'll show you the videos. So when it stimulates, these cells will light up. And the thing to notice is the middle one is a lot less interesting than the two ones on the sides. So normally we see this robust calcium response, but in the presence of ethanol alone, if we add antigen, we don't see a very interesting response. So I think this is an example of us being able to control a functional output of these cells with these perturbations. Maybe we understand what's going on. And so here's a quantification of those movies. It's just a fold increase of brightness of these fluorophores. And what we see is that when we add ethanol, we suppress this response dramatically. But when we add ethanol in combination with another compound that raises temperatures back up again, transition temperatures up, should restore the same level of fluctuations or so, we see our signal come back again. It's nice to have that as a control because maybe ethanol is doing something specific to one of these proteins and making it so things can't interact. And so the control of adding the other compound in as well and reversing it tells us that it's not a specific contribution of just the adding ethanol. So this again is a long way from being done. Our dream is to be able to kind of make one of these scaling plots of functional response versus how far you are away from this critical point. To see that this really is kind of not just a nice coincidence, but something that's probably related to, explainable by these theories. So the central question, again, was do cells exploit this interesting physical properties of their lipids to do some of these incredible things? And there's still a long, long, long to-do list, but I think that we're well on our way to showing that it's at least plausible. So I'm going to be in business for a little while, I hope. and in this case, I've only shown you examples in these immune cells, which are nice. There's a established literature suggesting that the lipids actually do contribute to these functional processes in kind of well-defined ways. So they're a great starting point for us. But we think there's the potential that it's much broader than this. And we have projects on many of these things going on in the lab now. Things like cell cycle control, so when cells decide to proliferate and when they decide to stop growing, and that's crucial for the development of cancers. General anesthesia, so these molecules that lower transition temperatures in vesicles that Ellie has been investigated are also general anesthetics, and so we're excited to think about maybe this is linked to the mechanism of general anesthesia. We have projects involved in HIV, viral assembly, and infection, endocytosis, temperature sensing. So these channels that measure temperature in our fingertips and stuff. Wouldn't it be cool if they measured temperature distance from a transition instead of absolute temperature? And so, I don't know, that also might be a pipe dream, but it's the type of thing that we're looking into now. The big picture is that I think that I have seen enough evidence from our experiments that this is a plausible way that cells, another knob that cells could turn to tune interactions between proteins. And this could actually do something. And there's a ton of work to be done. So we're only just learning how to manipulate this structure. And hopefully there's going to be many more ways of doing this soon. We're starting to tie this to function, but there's lots of avenues that still need to be explored. So far, we've shown consistency with this critical fluctuation picture, but we haven't shown that this is really what's going on, and I think that's one of the big next steps that we have to take. it's kind of crazy to think that cells have figured out a way to actually tune their membranes to a critical point. I didn't make this point very clear in the beginning, but in a model system, you have to work very hard to make sure you have everything just right to go through one of these critical points. It's a very small subset of total possibilities. And it appears that cells have done this on their own. They've chosen this composition, or this kind of subset of possible compositions. And how does it do this? How much work does this take? You know, so many questions that have yet to be answered. And one of the things that we're excited about is, do cells manipulate their lipids in disease? Like in cancers, do they know that lipids are going to push this cell cycle in a certain direction, so they tune their lipids in a certain way? And is this something that we can counterbalance by kind of new drug treatment strategies that target kind of lipid heterogeneity? So I don't know. I mean, big dreams, lots of things to do. But I think the possibilities out there are very exciting. So with that, I wanted to thank my group, and many of them are here, and they're the stars of this story. I'm very grateful for all the great work that they've done and that they've pushed this so much forward. I also want to thank you for listening to my crackly voice for this long, and I'm happy to take questions.